In this episode of OG55, we are talking about a lot of stuff. We are talking about Tiana's Bayou Adventure, okay? Soft openings, previews, but it's breaking down. Fire alarms are going off. What does this mean? Does this spell major problems for this attraction or not? We're going to talk about that. We're also going to talk about some big investments coming to Walt Disney World in terms of maybe a fifth park. We'll talk about even if they should even have a fifth park. We'll dive into that. We're also going to talk about these leaked photos about the Tropical Americas area coming to Disney's Animal Kingdom, the best park in Florida, actually, right? Animal Kingdom. We're going to talk about that. We have a lot to discuss today on this episode of OG55. Let's go, nerd. Welcome aboard, everybody, to another episode of OG55. We have a lot to discuss today. We're going to talk about these Tiana Bayou Adventure evacuations during their media or their previews or tech rehearsals, whatever they're calling it. We're also going to talk a lot about, Walt Disney World, the leaked art for the Encanto attraction, Tropical Americas. We're going to talk Fifth Gate. We have a lot to dive into, but George, the Italiano, looking really dapper with his new haircut. If you could let everybody at home know where they can find you on social media, sir.
Absolutely. You can find me on X, formerly known as Twitter, at Disney George. You could also find me on Instagram under the Disney Italiano. And of course, you can find me right here on my home base at Orange Grove 55 with Citrus Corner with all that sweet, juicy, but sometimes sticky Disney news and info. And speaking of Citrus Corner, I know you're probably all thinking, a lot of this has to do with Walt Disney World. Why isn't this a Citrus Corner? This is going to be, even though it is tapping into a lot of stuff in Florida, but this is also going to speak wide volume just all around for the Disney parks, just with the investments and everything that's going on. So I felt that it was quite fitting for it to just be an original flavor, if you will, of OG55.
Okay, let's dive into this, right? So we are seeing a lot of reports. This is fascinating. Tiana's Bayou Adventure is not officially open to the public until when? I believe it's what, June 28th. It is right now, at the time of this video, June 3rd. We got a long ways to go before we're not almost there. It's, well, I guess we kind of are, but we still got almost a month basically before this thing opens officially to the public. Right now we're doing previews, soft opens, right? Mm-hmm. And there's been, let's not sugarcoat it. There's been breakdowns. There have been breakdowns, and there's been fire alarms going off, right? And a lot of fans, I've seen a lot of discussion on X and social media in general about this situation. Like, what's going on with Tiana's? Why is it breaking down so much? Why are these fire alarms going off and yada, yada, yada? I want to address a couple of things. The first thing I want to address here is this is a re-theme of Splash Mountain, right? I'm going to state the obvious here, right? So a lot of people, and I understand where they're coming from with this, they're wondering, well, why would a retheme of a ride that's been there since the late 80s, or, well, in your case, I think in Florida, since the late early 90s, right?
90s, yes.
Yeah. So a long time, like 30 plus years, something like that. I suck at math, right? But anyway, so it's been there for a while. Why would it be having so many issues upon this retheme, okay? The thing is that really the only thing that they've kept is the flume, right? And like you have structures like little shacks, like the little, the little shacks and the structure, some of the structures you go up the lift hill in the beginning, and you have, the show building itself is obviously the same. But a lot of the stuff inside of the mountain is all new. It's all new. I mean, we have all new animatronics, state-of-the-art ones, by the way, state-of-the-art animatronics. Yes, I know, less of them, but they are more advanced than a lot of the animatronics that were in Splash Mountain. I've said it before many times. I can't speak for the Florida version, but a lot of our animatronics here at Disneyland looked like Br'er Rabbit, for example. He looked like a Teddy Ruxpin, okay? He looked like a stuffed animal with a motor in it. It wasn't the most amazing animatronic you've ever seen. I can assure you that. So these animatronics for Tiana's are way more advanced, okay? So that's one element. the other element, we have projection mapping, we have screens, we have all kinds of new technology in this show building now. So people are like, oh, well, it shouldn't be breaking down. This ride's old. Well, yeah, but it's all new technology that's in this thing now. That the new technology is what's likely causing issues, new sensors, whatever it is that they installed in it. That's what's having the problems. This was a significant retheme. They ripped a lot out and they added a lot in. Okay. So that's what's going on here. Now, here's the thing. This thing, like I said, isn't opening until June 28th. We have many more weeks, almost a month, really, until it opens. This is normal. This is why they're doing previews. This is why they're doing soft opens. If it was ready, it wouldn't be a soft opening, okay? The reason why they have soft openings is because they factor in the idea that they will have to shut this thing down. It's going to break. There's going to be glitches. There's going to be bugs and problems. That's the point of a soft opening. Literally, that is why they do these, to test and adjust with real people. You know what I'm saying? So that's mm-hmm. that. So am I worried, George? Am I worried that this thing is breaking down when it's not even supposed to open officially for another month? Absolutely not. Absolutely not. Now, before we move on to the fire alarm thing, what are your thoughts on the breakdowns in general?
Yeah, this is honestly, rides go through this all the time, especially when, yes, as you said, this is a newer type version of this ride. And a lot of people can argue and saying, well, it worked before, you know, why wasn't it working now? Yes, just as you had mentioned, a lot of new visual effects, a lot of new set pieces, a lot of obviously animatronics are in there. But even just aside from that, just take the building structure, the mountain itself. Yes, it's honestly, it's like as if you were to go away for a month on vacation and you shut your host on. And just to say, if you turn off your water, you turn off your electricity, what have you, what's going to happen? It sits. It kind of gets stale in a sense because it's not being used for so long. Right. So when you come back and you turn everything back on, guess what? The water may be a little bit discolored and everything. The electricity may kind of flicker. And you got to put that into perspective, but put it on a much grander scale, because this is right. a huge ride that is constantly running day in and day out for guests. Honestly, almost 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, 365 days a year.
Pretty much.
So these things are going to, here's a better example. It's like buying a brand new pair of shoes. You have to wear them. You have to get them adjusted onto your feet. You may get blisters. You may, have to stretch out the shoes a little bit. Right. It's the same thing of restarting back up a ride. You're going to get those hiccups, those bumps, those bugs, but you tweak them out. And that is the one thing that is unfortunate when you have early openings for any ride, not just for Tiana, because these are the issues that are going to happen.
Yes.
And you have to take into perspective, you have to wait till it actually officially opens. And even to then, things are going to happen. Look at even Rise of the Resistance, of how many times, and I know that a lot of times with Rise and Indiana Jones, it's because a lot of the times people don't listen to the cast members when they say, take off the hats, take off the mask.
Well, I was talking to a lead actually at Disneyland. He was a friend of a friend, I'll say that. And he told us that. He said a lot of times when Rise of the Resistance breaks down, it's not because the ride is broken. It's because someone dropped their hat on the floor. Now, this is a trackless vehicle. There's scanners underneath the floor. So when you drop something that could possibly impact the sensors, they got to shut the whole thing down and reboot it. You know what I'm saying? So mm-hmm. that's a huge thing. And that this is from somebody that was a lead on that attraction telling us this. It's not always broken. Like you said, George, people don't listen. So the mouse ears come down, someone drops their phone, someone drops a sweater. It could be a million different things, but he was saying most of the time, that's why. Now there are some things like the cannons that have been broken for a long time, probably never coming back. I get
actually
that,
yeah. Believe it or not, I don't think and do not quote me, I think this is what I heard also from a cast member, they're not necessarily broken. They actually have them turned off because what it was doing was, as it was pulling back, it was damaging the back interior of the wall or something with the floor or something. Okay. As it was pushing back and forth.
Oh, okay. That's weird.
That's what I heard. So they actually have them kind of turned off, sort of like the Yeti situation. Technically, right. The Yeti isn't broken. they have him on beam mode because as he's moving, it's cracking the part of the infrastructure of the mountain.
Exactly. Exactly. So, yeah. So things break, obviously, and especially when it's brand new. This thing is like just barely opening for previews. Look, it's expected that there's going to be a period of time that there is going to be some breakdowns or even a lot of breakdowns. That's why they have these previews and these soft opens. Okay. So now the other question is, what's going on with the fire alarm? Because I'm hearing reports on Twitter. I'm hearing reports all over the place, not just Twitter, all over the place that there's fire alarms going off. This isn't normal, George. Fire alarms. I mean, this is not normal. What's going on?
But it only happens at Disney, right?
Yeah. Oh, you're right. Yeah. Only at Disney. Yeah. Well, look, here's the thing. And I want to make it very clear. I want to make it very, very clear because I'm going to be bringing up Universal. I don't want people to think that I'm
the biggest hater. I hate the way that you walk, the way that you do.
I'm not a Universal hater. I'm actually going to defend them in a little bit. Just bear with me here. When Super Nintendo, here we go. When Super Nintendo World opened, this is from Universal Park News today. This was January 15th, 2023. Now, this is, I believe, before the land opened. This is during their media preview or their soft opens, right? A fire alarm went off inside Toadstool Cafe when we were eating. So the restaurant, the ride, and the shop were evacuated. Everyone is hanging around the land waiting for the all clear to enter again. Go on, go, you know, look, there's it's not just that. I mean, it happened a lot. Okay. This is on February 5th. This person, Lewis, what a mess. The fire alarm went off at Super Nintendo World and the employees didn't even know what to do. I mean, this was going on like crazy, you guys. This was going on like crazy during their media previews, during their soft opens. I don't know what. Now, look, I'll be honest. I'm not an operations guy, to be honest with you. I'm not really versed in the operations stuff, right? But this is the most recent example is why I'm bringing it up. This happens with new stuff. This happens, and it happened a lot with Super Nintendo World with the fire alarms, because I remember reading about it all the time. It was going on constantly, and how the land is basically coded as one building. So they have to evacuate the whole thing if one element of it has a problem. So if Toadstool goes down, everything has to be evacuated because it's coded by the, I don't know if it's like the county or whatever, it's coded as one structure, the entire land. Okay. There's a whole thing about this. And when this thing was doing their soft opens, it was happening constantly. So when I hear like, well, what's going on with Tiana's? It's breaking down, the fire alarms. You guys, this is what happened. It happened with Nintendo World too. This isn't like some Tiana Bayou adventure exclusive here. Now, I was hard on Universal during the tech rehearsals, but this was not really necessarily what I wasn't hard on Universal for things breaking down during a soft opening. What I was more hard on Universal for was it was filthy. Okay.
There were lack of maintenance,
right? There were vents over by the restrooms that were black, you know, dirt, the hills around the land looked dented and in bad shape. That stuff is beyond the purview of a tech rehearsal. That's my issue with the land, but Mario Kart breaking down is completely normal for a tech rehearsal. Okay. When you're talking about fire alarms, that might be part of some testing thing they're doing with that. That seems pretty normal. Right. So this was happening at Universal as well. OK, so do I think that this Tiana thing with the fire alarms and breaking down is worrisome? No, because it's so early in the game. But like you were saying, George, if let's say this is still going on when it opens or 2 weeks or a month after it opens. OK, then. OK, call Disney out. Look, this is unacceptable. You know, you were supposed to get this done and ready by June 28th. OK, but it's a little early, you guys, to be sitting there going, wow, it's breaking down. It's brand new. It just started their soft openings. You know, look, we did a video recently, George, about the Universal Studios Hollywood tram accident. Pretty significant accident. Actually, I don't think you were on that one. I believe it was Jay Shear. I was doing it with Jay and our boy Tom.
Yes, I was. Yeah, I was.
You were in California. We were very fair to Universal. In fact, I said in that video, you know, look, things break, things happen, human error. We shouldn't come down too hard on Universal. Go back to that video. You'll see it. All three of us were saying the same thing, you know, and that's how I feel about this stuff. Like things break, things happen, you know, and it's not, you know, it's not the end of the world. I think with Tiana's, same situation, and especially for Tiana's because it is so new. But what are your thoughts, George?
Yeah, I, as I was saying before, it's like this happens everywhere, you know, whether it's Disney, Universal, SeaWorld, definitely Six Flags. Yeah. But it's, shit's going to happen, you know, right. And it's like, it's not really the fact that it happens because it's out of anyone's control. You know, it's just, what is important is how Disney handles it operational wise. You know, that's how it's, you know, do they get it back up on time? You know, where they can get, keep the guest flow and the line moving, you know, what have you, you know, I get it. It's probably a lot of yellow and red tape that we don't even know because just like you, I'm not even in operations. I don't know if it's all incorporated with that.
Yeah, I don't really, it's not my thing. So I don't really dive into that stuff, you know, but I've been around the park community enough to know that these soft opens are riddled with breakdowns. That's why they do them.
Exactly. So it's basically, it's working out the kinks. And I hate to say that cast members, APs and D23 members are basically the guinea pigs of it. And if you're going to do it, you have to have that mindset that there's a possibility you may be on the ride when there's something that happens, you know, an error or a shutdown or an evac or a fire alarm or what have you. You have to kind of put it in your mind that there is a strong possibility. And that's what happens when you have early access or soft opening or these test runs or what have you, because it's basically they want to see how the ride functions with people in it. And this is how they keep it maneuvering. So in a way, when this stuff happens, it's, I kind of hate to say this, it's kind of a good thing that it's happening now. So that way they know how to work it operational if it happens to go down the road after the fact that it's officially opened.
Yeah, that's the point of test and adjust is to see where there's issues, how do you fix those issues, yada, yada, yada. So, yeah, you know, I'm not worried at all. Now, like I said, I'm not going to give Disney a pass forever, though. OK, like if this isn't in August or something, we're still having these problems. Dude, that's not acceptable. You know what I'm saying? Exactly. Disney's got to be held accountable. But we're like just a few days into these soft opens. I think we're okay right now. Let's let them work the kinks out. Another thing I want to touch upon real quick, George, before we actually move on to Encanto and the Tropical Americas over at Animal Kingdom, which is, by the way, the best park in Walt Disney World. I don't know if I mentioned that before. Is the Disney point of view video that the god awful, let's be honest, that video was terrible quality.
It was done wrongfully. I'm sorry, Disney. There was so many ways that you could have handled that. You basically took control over your own project and you could have controlled it in how many ways it was handed to you by yourself on a silver platter and you completely dropped it. You dropped the ball.
Yeah, they absolutely dropped it. I mean, it was terrible, and it was a mounted. I was watching Disney Drew this morning. Great guy, by the way. Check out his content. Absolutely, I love his passion for Tiana's is really seriously contagious. But he was talking about how it was a mounted camera, right? Mm-hmm. And so it was like a GoPro or something, right? It's like, come on, Disney. But it was like a mounted camera. And so it would just kind of, and we were talking actually to Theme Park Wizard about this on his live show recently too, where it was kind of like mounted and locked into position. So it was kind of like, you know, going through the ride. The issue is, and Disney Drew brought this up, and I think he made a great point, where when you have a camera like that, it's a very unnatural perspective because when you're a guest in that log, you're not going to be like this the whole time. You know what I'm saying? You're not going to be, your head's not like this unless you broke your neck and you have a brace. You're going to look around. So when you're going through the attraction, you're going to look to your left. You're going to look to your right. You're going to look around like everyone does in an attraction, like you do with pirates, like you do just about anything, Small World. So that point of view, video that Disney dropped was terrible, both in quality and the fact that it was mounted like that. It didn't do the ride any justice. Now, I'm not saying that video is going to take, if you think the ride is a C+ ride, that's not going to bring the attraction to an A+ for you. I'm not saying that. But I am saying is that other videos that we saw from vloggers and other media looked a whole lot better and showed off that attraction much better than the Disney one. Okay. The biggest studio in the world can't produce an on-ride video properly. That says a lot. That's kind of ridiculous.
Yeah, okay? That's pretty bad.
That's ridiculous. Okay. So it didn't do the ride any favors. It really didn't. And so anyway, that video, they dropped it and it went on YouTube. Now that video is getting ratioed like crazy. I think the downvotes, I don't know the exact numbers, but the downvotes are way higher than the upvotes, than the likes. Okay. What do I think? And I'm curious about your opinion on this, George. What do I think about that? What do I think about, oh my gosh, the downvotes are so bad and it outnumbers the likes. Honestly, if you would have asked me 6 months ago, I would have told you this was going to happen. This attraction is a very, very sensitive situation for a lot of people. Okay. Mm-hmm. And a lot of arguing on Twitter about Tiana's Bayou Adventure, both sides of the argument. These kind of hot button kind of topics in the park community or any fandom, you're going to have these kind of pushes when it comes to like the downvotes or Rotten Tomatoes or things like that, where people like want to make their point. Oh man, I don't like why they're retheming this. So I'm going to go on there. I'm going to downvote. So that's what you're seeing with this. These are not organic numbers. This is not the normies, the general public going out of their way. All these soccer moms are downvoting this thing. Oh my God, man, this ride totally sucks. It's not the normies, you guys. These are people that on both sides are going, you know what? I love this thing. I'm going to upvote it. Oh, you know what? I don't like it because of this, that, and the other. I'm going to downvote. These are diehard fans on both sides that are influencing these numbers. And it's not something that's indicative of an organic, what's the word for it? Organic measure, barometer of where the normies stand with this. Okay. It's totally overblown. And that's why, look, let's wait and see what the normies think about it when the thing opens. Okay.
Cause this thing honestly is normie driven. I feel like I'm not saying that the ride isn't for us, but I think it kind of caters to the normie a little bit more because a normie isn't going to stop and really dig a little deeper, so to speak, into the overall back. They just want a good ride.
Well, and the normies aren't nitpicking like we are. I nitpick. I'm a nerd. I nitpick. Yeah, nitpick. You know, we all nitpick to some degree more than the average person does. You know, if I ask my coworkers about, you know, the signage or something like that, they would look at me like I'm crazy. Like they don't care about that stuff. You know, so we nitpick. But the normies aren't like that. You know what I'm saying? And I'm telling you, the normies aren't the ones downvoting this video. Here's the other thing. We don't even know when I'm a content creator. Each downvote doesn't give you an explanation as to why that person downvoted it. There could be people who love the attraction, who had fun on the attraction and are downvoting the video because they thought the quality sucked.
See, and that's the issue with social media that I feel like that it feels to me that it kind of cripples a person's perspective of how they see something where before social media, before, you know, platforms and what have you, it was basically you find out about it in a planning video, a brochure, newspaper, what have you. You go to the park and you experience it yourself. And then some people like write news articles and, you know, reviews on it and what have you, but it's an afterthought.
Right.
With social media, it's constantly circulating. It's constantly out there. So, and the way people think nowadays because of social media and technology, their minds are running 100 miles an hour and you just don't stop, sit back and smell the beignets, so to speak. It's always on a go mode. Right. And you want to hurry up and you want to, you know something right away or expect something right away. And it's like, you just have to have patience. I always say people are in a rush nowadays to get to nowhere in particular.
Yeah, that was good. That was good. No, absolutely. Absolutely. And so I don't put a lot of stock, and it's not just into the Tiana's Bayou Adventure.
Yeah, it's just everything.
Everything. Anything that's at all controversial, you're going to have this sort of, you're going to see these kind of ratios, whether it's a video, whether it's Rotten Tomatoes, and it's kind of beyond the normie thing. It's really a fandom thing, and it doesn't really matter at the end of the day. Mm-hmm. And like I said before, we don't even know why they're disliking the video. It could be because the video quality sucks and has nothing to do with Tiana's itself. You don't get an explanation as a content creator why someone is disliking the video. It could be for a million and a half different reasons.
Exactly.
So anyway, look, if I go on Tiana's and I don't like the ride, I'll come on here and I'll say I don't like the ride. When I went on, I used to talk so much shit about Mario Kart, okay, about how dumb it is to have a slow racing ride. I went on Mario Kart and I walked out of there and I loved it. I absolutely thought it was fantastic. And I got on camera and I said, hey, you know what? I was wrong. From what I'm seeing from Tiana, from the videos, just from the videos, I think it looks like a really, really good attraction. Do we have criticism, George? Absolutely,
absolutely.
We do. We've made multiple videos now. We did a live show with Wizard, laying out our critiques. We did our own video. I'm telling you right now, we have critiques. The thing is not perfect. We don't like the CGI, Tiana and Lewis. We don't like a lot of things with this. You know, some of the signage doesn't look right. There are problems there, but I still think it looks like overall a really good ride. I think they did what they had to work with and turning this into Tiana. I think they did a really good job, you know, but again, it's just a video. So when we ride it, we can give our actual opinion. But based on the video, I think it looks pretty good. You know what I'm saying? And if you don't think it looks good, that's fine, though. There's nothing wrong with that. You know what I'm
Absolutely.
Saying? So, yeah. But that's just kind of where I stand, George. But any final thoughts before we kind of skedaddle?
Yeah, no. I just – all I have to say is to everyone is just take a step back. Take a breather. We're all going to get through this. You know, it's like not only give the ride a chance, give yourself a chance to experience the ride once you ride it.
Right.
You know, it's like, don't always have that knee jerk reaction that even if you do hear a bad review, okay, it may be a bad review to that particular person, but that's just like, OG isn't a seafood eater. He doesn't like seafood.
No,
I love seafood. If he was to write a review about seafood, it's not going to be in good liking. But for someone like me, I would write a positive side of seafood. Each person has something to their own liking. And the only way that you can depict that for yourself is by experiencing it yourself.
You have to experience this stuff yourself, and you have to go in there and if you look, that's the thing. If you go and ride Tiana's and you don't like it, that's fine. If you go and ride Tiana's and you love it, that's also fine. You know, but you should go and experience it. Cause look, I'll be honest with you. I've been a lifelong Disney fan. You know what I'm saying? And I've seen video and pictures and all kinds of content about Disney's Hollywood Studios. Uh-huh. I always thought this was going to be my least favorite park at Walt Disney World. Turned out it wasn't. Turned out I was actually pretty impressed by Hollywood Studios. I liked it.
Over Magic Kingdom.
I put it over Magic Kingdom. Absolutely. I did not expect that. So I changed my opinion because I went there and experienced it. And that changes the dynamic when you actually experience something, mm-hmm. you know? So, you know, we'll see. We'll see how it shakes out. But overall, before we move on to before we move on to Encanto, just want to say to wrap this up into a nice little bow. The breakdowns, the fire alarms, personally, I'm not concerned. That's why we have previews and soft openings. Now, again, it's early. If this still happens in a month, that's a whole different situation. In terms of the video being downvoted and stuff, not surprised at all. It's a hot button issue with fans. It's gonna draw that kind of attention, and people are gonna go out of their way to vote up or down based on their own whatever their agenda or based on their own belief system, whatever it is, it's going to garner that kind of attention, this attraction. And those numbers we're seeing are not necessarily organic. These are not numbers you're seeing from like the normies doing this. This is fandom. Okay. I'm telling you that right now, but we'll see. And we'll see if this ride is successful when it opens and the normies are able to experience it. In my opinion, and this is my opinion, I do believe the normies are going to like this attraction. I do believe they will enjoy it. I seem to remember a lot of pushback with Frozen Ever After, you know, taking over for Maelstrom, you know, amongst our circles. But when it opened to the normies were like climbing over each other to get into this thing. They loved it. They want the Elsa ride.
And if you ask a normie, what did Frozen Ever After replace? 9 out of 10, they probably won't even remember.
And not to say Splash Mountain. I mean, Splash Mountain is obviously more popular than Maelstrom was, but it's kind of the same idea. You know, the normies are going to have a different perspective than the diehard fans like us. They're probably going to love the Tiana ride. Let's be honest. This is built for normies. So we'll see. But next topic, George, we have leaked concept art reveals reveals new look at Encanto attraction and the Tropical America's Dinoland USA retheme. So this is courtesy of blog Mickey. It says here, the new concept art has leaked on social media, appearing to give a new look at the Tropical America's retheme for Dinoland USA at the Animal Kingdom. The leak comes via Phi Bell. We follow Bell, and she's awesome. Really sweet lady. She's really cool. Check her out on X. Here she is. It's at FI Bell FI. She's really sweet. So she says here, Tropical America's concept art. These pieces show a different vantage point than what was released so far. The most important thing to me is that on both, we see macaws in the sky, a potential relocation of the show. That's interesting. And it says here, originally the land was approved with no animals. Interesting. So we're not seeing budget cuts. It looked like we're seeing some additions, which is kind of a rare thing. Very rare. Well, kudos though, right? You got to give them credit where credit is due. If this is true, this is beautiful, by the way. Absolutely beautiful. This is the house from Encanto, the magical house from Encanto. I've said it all along, George, if they don't utilize the Mystic Manor ride system for this Encanto ride, I don't know what they're doing over there. Yeah. This is tailor made.
It was made for it.
I mean, come on, right?
I know that there's not too much, you know, to go off of here. These are just two pieces just to kind of give, as it mentions in the description, like a different viewpoint of what it would look like. But yeah, based off of what it looks like, it looks phenomenal. I don't know if they just added the macaws just for like the backdrop. However, if they do move the macaw flight over there, I think it would fit so well with the color scheme, and I just think it would be perfect. Now I do find it interesting when Belle mentioned that there are no like animal exhibits and what have you. Now, this can kind of go one of two ways, and this is what I wanted to kind of bring up because I think this is quite interesting. I'm okay with adding animal exhibits into this because then it could kind of tie into for Animal Kingdom.
Right.
That's the plus side. On the not so plus side, that this is the one part of the park that you can kind of get away from the actual live animals, because over on the African, Asia, Rafiki's Planet Watch side, that's where you have a lot of the animals, and that's where a lot of the animals go for the night into their separate enclosures or you know, whatever the term is. I'm not 100% sure, but the big issue with Animal Kingdom as to why they can't stay open past certain amount of hours is because of the animals. So if they want to add any kind of nighttime effects to this, if they want to add something, they can't do that if they have animal exhibits over here.
Yeah, that's interesting. Now, are there any animal exhibits in the general area that could be like maybe not necessarily in this land, but that's around this area that would impact?
The only one that I know of is over by where they had Donald's Dino Bash. Okay. That's like off, like it's out of this generalized area, but they have like where they have the gator sightings, like in like a little swamp pond area. that was the only thing that I think that they had over there. Now, I don't know if the Gators are staying there or if they're going to get relocated.
Okay. Interesting. 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 Okay. Let's look at some of this other art, because there was more than just one. This is beautiful, by the way. I absolutely love this. Animal Kingdom will continue to be my favorite park after this expansion. And this is actually a huge plus, because Dinoland's ugly, dude.
Oh, it is. It's literally one of the last remaining lands that it hasn't gotten really any updates, aside from Chester and Hester's Dino-Rama that got it added, but that didn't help the land much.
No.
So I'm very glad that they're adding this as an addition. I think this would bring so much color into the park, especially since it's tying into the Tropical Americas, a South American kind of notion. And if they do want to add an animal feature to it, I do hope they add the macaw flight. I think that would be so cool to have it over the house. And you're absolutely right. This looking at this screams Mystic Manor.
It's like, come on. It's obvious. It's obvious that's what you do with it. You know what I'm saying? God, I hope they do that. But this looks really cool, man. I'm really digging this. This is why I love Animal Kingdom. This kind of stuff where you feel transported. Like, I felt like I was in Asia when I was going through Asia. I felt like I was in Africa. Like, the authenticity for this park is through the roof, man. And the layout is so different than any other park. You know, they kind of laid it out where it feels like you're like on like a little adventure, kind of like you're exploring. I know that sounds really cheesy, but it does. It feels different, you know? It doesn't feel like manufactured like a lot of other theme parks do. It felt very organic.
Yeah, so I think this is actually great. I like the new entranceway because it kind of depicts of like where you possibly could be going into to explore this new land. And based off of the concept art, I see the macaws up there too. So I don't think that's a coincidence that they add the flying macaws in two pieces of concept art. Now, again, that can change over time. But I'm kind of digging that if they do have the macaw flight, that it would be kind of cool to have it in the Tropical Americas. Because, I mean, where else would you find macaws is in South America, you know? Yeah. And me personally, that also leaves a lot of potential expansion, I feel, for the Tropical Americas. Because I've said it so many times before. I know that they're kind of throwing off like an Indiana Jones vibe into that mixed with Encanto. But honestly, I would also love to see possibly Up going into there as well. It's set in South America for Paradise Falls. They already have the characters incorporated into the parks. You can meet Doug and Russell with the Wilderness Explorers area. Kevin is walking around the park. And I just think that it would be a nice permanent home to add Up into there. And honestly, even if you want to take it a little bit further back, you could add in the Three Caballeros, you know?
Oh man, that would be awesome. That would be absolutely awesome. And we talk a lot here about Disneyland Forward. That is the kind of stuff I want to see with that, with the DCA expansion, right? You can even do a Latin, almost like a Latin Fantasy Springs kind of style, exactly. Land, right, where you have Encanto, Coco, and like the Three Caballeros, or even Up. I mean, it takes place in what, South America, right?
South America.
Yeah. So there's so many options there. That's what I want to see in DCA. I'll take Pandora, but Disney, you gotta come up with something. Either you gotta change the name or you gotta come up with a good reason why it's in California. And you know me, dude, I'm pretty forgiving with stuff. Like people are like, oh, you know, Cars Land is technically Arizona. It is, but it's like car culture, Route 66. There's enough California there where I'm fine with that. But Pandora, okay, that's a little bit more of a stretch. So we'll see. But I don't want to digress too far. But yeah, before we move on to our next topic, this is awesome. This South America land is going to be such a step up from that Dinoland USA. That Dinoland USA area reminds me so much, and I think it was actually around the same time that it was end Eisner years. Yes. Around that, like DCA 1.0 and all that, where he was just getting real cheap, dude.
Yeah.
Like, I don't see. And this feels like DCA 1.0, Dinoland. Get rid of it. The park, Animal Kingdom is too good of a park for this kind of land.
And I think with the Tropical America section too, aside from the attractions that's going to go in there, I just think the overall aesthetics of the land itself is going to be beautiful.
Oh, gorgeous, man. Gorgeous. With like the Encanto house, the beautiful flowers and the vines growing up on the house and everything. And just amazing. And it's like you said, they have the macaws. You're gonna have beautiful birds flying around. Absolutely breathtaking. We'll see. Hopefully Josh D'Amaro comes through at the D23 Expo and we don't get a bunch of maybe, what if, could, shoulda, woulda.
How many more fairy tale stories about your life till we had enough?
No more fairy tale stories, what if, maybe, none of that, Daddy Josh. We want real deal. Greenlit stuff. Yeah. No more.
How many more fairy tale stories about your life till we had enough?
Come on, we had enough. We want real announcements. And I think we're going to get it. To be fair to Josh, I really do think we're going to get some good stuff this time.
We better. We have to.
We have to. And honestly, he has to because he's in contention to be the next CEO. How do I feel about that? I don't know. But like, if he doesn't deliver on this and fans are like ticked off, he's got trouble. Yeah. On his own front for that CEO spot. So we will see. All right. Now moving on to our next topic. We have new parks, hotels, and restaurants. What to know about the proposed Disney expansion in Florida. Crazy stuff. We're actually talking about expansions now in Florida, which is awesome. Because you know what? It's been too long. We've had a lot of political limbo out there for a long time. Now we're getting... some, as George says, some meat and potatoes. All right. So we're going to, this is only a 2-minute video. So let's play this. And if you want me to pause it, George, just let me know. And we'll talk about it. Here we go.
New details tonight on the expansion of Walt Disney World.
Yeah. For more than a year, Disney CEO Bob Iger has been promising new parks and attractions would deliver about 13,000 new local jobs.
Tonight, West 2's Greg Fox looks at the agreement now in place to launch 2 decades of growth.
Yeah, now, real quick, I do want to say, I think you brought this up to me on the phone, George, and you make a great point. This is the first time that I can remember, and you brought this up, that we have Disney World and Disneyland Resort both going through pretty significant expansions right now.
Mm-hmm.
I mean,
At the same time.
I think that's very, very interesting. Very exciting.
Disney's 24,000-acre property is already the largest entertainment footprint in the region, and it's getting bigger. A development agreement that will go to the Central Florida Tourism Oversight District Board next Wednesday spells out a major expansion, including the addition of a fifth major park to join the Magic Kingdom, Epcot, Animal Kingdom, and the Hollywood Studios.
Okay, so I want to talk about that. So this proposal that they're voting on this upcoming week, right?
Mm-hmm.
It gives Disney the option for a fifth gate. Okay. So what do we think about that, George? What do you think? You think we're getting a fifth park anytime soon, or what? Or is this just kind of like we want the option if we want to do it later on, kind of thing?
Right. I would hope that it would be coming down the pipeline later than sooner. I know I'm probably in the less demographics of that, and the reason why is because Disney needs to focus on the 4 theme parks they have already.
Yeah.
Once they lock that into place down the road, 15, 20 years from now, they can focus on that. Because as you had mentioned many times before, when any kind of property, whether it's Disney, Universal, and Universal's probably going to take a little bit of a hit even with Epic Universe, that when it opens, it could start cannibalizing its own properties. And this goes the same for Disney World too. If they add a fifth gate right now, obviously people are going to be flocking to it, which is great. But what does that do for the other theme parks? Animal Kingdom is still a half day park. It never stays open past 7 p.m. Hollywood Studios need some more things. Magic Kingdom is desperately in need for more stuff, because we'll dive into that in a little bit too, with some filing permits that are also in motion with that as well. But they need to focus on the parks they have right now. Now, 15, 20 years down the road, they can possibly look into that. I'm glad that they'll have the option to do so. Now, could it potentially still happen? I'm kind of on the maybe side, because the fact that they're actually mentioning this on a new station. Now, I know that they mentioned Disneyland Forward with the new station, but the wording, I don't know if the new station isn't getting the full details on that, but based off of how they're saying it, it almost sounds like it's like, okay, they are going to do this. But I don't think that's necessarily the case for that. I think it's just the notion that, again, with like Disneyland Forward, they have the option to do so from this investment.
Yeah, I think it's just the option. And I think right now, I would agree with you, George. I've said it many times. I don't think a fifth park right now is what Disney World needs. I know a lot of fans want them to do that because they think that Disney needs to respond to Epic Universe with another park for park kind of situation. And I think it's a bad idea. I think Disney needs to do what's best for Disney. Universal is doing what's best for Universal. Universal right now is in market share growth mode. They're trying to get more market share, right?
Right.
So they got to do what they got to do to get more market share. Kind of like Disney. When Disney came onto the streaming industry, came into the streaming world, they were in market share mode. So what did Disney do? They priced themselves way cheap. And that first year, remember that, how cheap it was to get that market share. Once they got the market share, though, their strategy and their tactic changed. You can't apply Universal's market share strategy to Disney World, because Disney World is a more mature resort. We already have four parks, two water parks. It's already a mature complex. You can't apply the same set of circumstances to it. So a fifth park, I think right now at least, I think would do more damage to the resort than good. You would cannibalize the hell out of a lot of these parks at Walt Disney World, because a lot of them, like Animal Kingdom, needs a lot of stuff to really bring it up to par. I know for people like me, I'm not a big ride person. I like atmosphere. I that's why I love Animal Kingdom. I can sit in Animal Kingdom all day long and just soak it in. But a lot of normies.
With the trees.
With the trees and a beer, I'm good. But the thing is, with the normies, though, they're not there to do that and just hang out. They're there to like do the ride thing and want back to back to back to back. So with Animal Kingdom having like kind of like a very short roster of rides, and then you add a fifth gate, well, now you're really jeopardizing Animal Kingdom. You know what I'm saying? And you're jeopardizing even maybe Hollywood Studios and stuff like that. So it's not a good idea. What Walt Disney World needs to do right now, get out of the mindset of a fifth gate and just work on the parks you have. So you add to Magic Kingdom, you know, do Beyond Big Thunder, which we'll talk about in a little bit. Do, Animal Kingdom stuff, expand that, you know. Hollywood Studios needs stuff too. All of these parks do. They all need stuff. Yeah. Flush these parks out. Then maybe in 20, 25, 30 years, you can maybe address a third gate. But like I said before too, there's only so much time and money people have. Like, right now, it's already pushing it, dude. Like, you have four theme parks in at Disney, and you're going to have three very soon at Universal. That's not even including the water parks. What are people don't have unlimited PTO for work. What are you going to do? You're going to spend 2.5 weeks in Florida. How are you going to hit all this stuff? It's going to get even harder and harder. So families are going to have to start making some decisions here.
Yeah.
And Disney and Universal might have to change their approach with this stuff. They might have to lean into the local market more or something, because families cannot stay here this long and do everything. It's getting harder and harder to do it. Go ahead, George.
And I feel like that the demographic that they're aiming for is still for tourism, for traveling families. And I think that's quite interesting that they would take that approach. And I feel like what it's going to end up coming down to is kind of like the old fashioned good old days, where it was like, you either had to pick or choose. Are we doing a Walt Disney World vacation, or are we doing a Universal vacation? Because we can't do both. See, now they kind of hit that sweet spot where it's like, okay, well, we could do a couple days at Universal while we stay at Walt Disney World, or vice versa. Because we only are limited to, as what you had just mentioned, so much that we can do in this short amount of time. Now that they keep on adding things to add more capacity, and it's going to stretch out those vacation days, then yeah, I think it's going to have to go back to, hey, this year, do you want to do Disney World or do you want to do Universal?
Well, and it could impact too. I mean, I've said it a long time. You've said it for a long time. People assume that the cannibalization from Epic Universe is only going to hurt Disney. I am telling you guys right now, I don't think that's necessarily the case. I'm not saying that that's not going to happen. Okay. I want to make it very clear. I'm just saying you shouldn't leave out the option, or the possibility is a better word, of it possibly cannibalizing some of Universal's own parks. I think it's a very, very good possibility.
That especially would, the studios, the Universal studios. I mean, I know that they just opened the DreamWorks area, but like that's not like a heavy hitter. I mean, the latest biggest thing that they opened was Diagon Alley.
From 2014, I think.
2014, yeah. And
we're talking a decade ago now.
And then, of course, they added some, like, things added in there. Like, you have
the Minions.
The Minions ride. You have the Bourne stunt show. You have the god-awful Fast and the Furious Supercharge. But it's, like, it's not going to withhold a new theme park that's going on property.
If what they're promising is accurate, which I'm still iffy on that too, to be honest with you, the most technologically advanced and all that stuff. Cause I've been to Mario World here in California. It's a cute land, but I don't walk away from Super Mario World going like, to call it my sister or my mom or family or friends or coworkers and being like, Super Nintendo World is so advanced. I've never experienced anything like that before. No. It's a cute Toontown-ish style land. And there's nothing wrong with it being that. But, you know, I mean, look, Universal has said that's, I remember like the lead up to Nintendo World is so advanced technologically and all this stuff. It's like, okay, I don't know, you know? So let's just see. Let's see if Epic Universe lives up to what they're promising. It could, we don't know yet. But if it does live up to what Universal is promising of it being just this absolute mind-blowing experience, how is the studio park over there at Universal even going to compete with like VillainCon and stuff like that? And even this new DreamWorks land, which looks really budgeted like crazy, you know, it's a value engineered thing. You could totally see it, right? How is that park going to compete with this thing? I don't think it can. I think it will cannibalize. Even Island of Adventure is starting to see signs of wear and tear a little bit, right? It's going to be tough. So it's going to be interesting to see how this whole dynamic works out. But they might have to, Universal and Disney might have to change their approach with tourism and the local market. Because I think what they might have to do is lean into maybe the local market a little more to kind of fill in some gaps here. Because, like I said, the tourists are going to make a decision as to what park to cancel out. Disney and Universal might have to lean on locals to kind of fill in those gaps a little bit. Right. So we'll see. It's going to be very interesting. I'm very, very curious as to what happens when Epic Universe opens.
Two new minor parks joining smaller attractions like the water parks, Fort Wilderness, and Disney Springs. The agreement spells out $17 billion in growth over the next 10 to 20 years, with at least an $8 billion capital investment in the first 10 years. Disney will also commit $10 million to attainable housing. That means in Orange County...
It kind of reminds me a lot of the Disneyland Forward stuff.
Yeah, it does.
To be honest with you.
Yeah, you know? It really does. And Disney giving $10 million for affordable housing. How dare they?
Oh, man. Yeah, it's crazy.
Where the median income for a four-person household is just over $90,000 a year. Attainable housing would be earmarked for low-income households earning about $77,000 a year. That's 80% of the median income.
I like this stuff, though. I really do. I like that Disney's getting more collaborative with the local communities and less combative. We've seen so many times, at least out here in Anaheim, how combative Disney can get with the local businesses and stuff. Now, look, I think I'll be real with you. I think the local businesses and even the residents in Anaheim can cut. A lot of times they're out of pocket. A lot of times it's a little obnoxious. Okay. I'm not going to lie. When you move into Disneyland's backyard and then you're going to complain that the noise and the traffic is like, okay, well,
and California, the fireworks. And it's,
yeah, like, come on. California is a big place. Why is you move next to Disneyland? It's like moving next door to Ruth Chris Steakhouse. And you're like, oh man, I don't like the smell of meat. Well, why is you move next door to Ruth Chris Steakhouse? Right. Doesn't make any sense, but besides the fact, I do think it overall is good that they are working with residents, doing affordable housing, stuff like this. They're doing it here in California. They're doing it here in Florida. A very, very good thing.
Mm-hmm. Disney is already planning to build 1,400 units on Hartzog Road in Horizon West near the 429 toll road. 1,000 of those units will be considered affordable. Disney already has nearly 40,000 hotel rooms and will build more in the next two decades. The expansion will add 13,666 rooms and nearly 270,000 square feet of new retail and restaurant space. That's about the size of two Walmart stores at full build-out. The head of the Central Florida Tourism Oversight District tells West 2 News, with Walt Disney World's substantial investments, we anticipate economic growth, job creation, and support for local businesses alongside environmental stewardship and workforce housing initiatives benefiting Central Florida's community. A fifth major theme park would add new firepower in the local theme park wars, with Universal opening its third gate, Epic Universe, next year. So far, Disney has not announced a name, theme, or location for a fifth park. At Disney, Greg Fox, West 2 News.
Yeah, I think you're right. I think it's for the potential. The option is there if they want to. I think it would be, and I've stood by this, I think it would be a mistake to jump into a third park right now. I think that there's so much going on with the other parks that need attention. And I also do think that you're getting to a point, even later on, I mean, things might change, but you're getting to a kind of a point where it's, like I said before, people only have so much time to spend on vacation, money-wise, time-wise, everything. So you're getting to a point where it's like getting really tough to do this. And five parks is a lot. That's a lot of stuff to do. I don't know. We'll see. It's interesting, though. It's very, very interesting. I'm just happy that we're finally getting some investments out here.
On a positive track. Like, after, like, many years of, like, nothing but, like, negativity and Disney, like, spiraling down the barrel, it's like, It's a breath of fresh air, honestly.
Oh, it absolutely is. It's really good to see some positive stuff happening over there. And we're getting some positive stuff here in Anaheim, too. So good things are happening. This is from the Disney Food Blog. Disney confirms permit to begin massive Magic Kingdom expansion. Okay. Interesting. Disney has been teasing us with little updates and reminders about a huge expansion that's being planned for Magic Kingdom. Up until now, it seemed like every announcement is more and more vague, right? The Josh D'Amaro.
How many more fairy tale stories about your life till we have?
You know what I'm saying? How many more fairy tale stories, right? More and more vague without any concrete promises. But it looks like Disney might be finally putting this plan into action. You might need a little bit of background info. Before we dive into it, a couple years ago, Disney announced a Blue Sky project that would bring a new land or lands to Magic Kingdom, which was the Beyond Big Thunder, Beyond, this thing. So it looks like there have been, give me just a moment, let me go down here. It says here, Disney previously announced that they are planning to invest a lot into their parks over the next 10 years. In fact, they're going to invest about $60 billion in the parks, experiences, and product segment of the company. In the coming decade, part of the budget will include a Magic Kingdom expansion. The new permits aren't the only indication that real work is getting started on this project. Earlier this year, we noticed an interesting section in the 2023 RCID long-term land use plan that may have given us a clue about the possible upcoming expansion. In this plan, Disney outlined some big changes from its last land use plan proposed in 2020, including a new designation for land use called marginally unsuitable. These areas are considered to have recognizable restraints for development, such as proximity to wetlands within the next 100-year flood elevation. So they're dropping permits now for this Beyond Big Thunder expansion. And who knows what it could be. It could be, you know, we talked about it, Villains Land. It could be something else. What Coco. Do you think? I mean, it could be Coco. This is the thing, George. I mean, we joke a lot about DeMauro and not announcing anything, but with permits being filed for both Magic Kingdom and for Animal Kingdom now, it's looking pretty secure that we're going to get some announcements for both of these.
I think so. Like, before, I was thinking that Big Thunder was kind of like way off in the distance, no pun intended.
Like beyond
the beyond. But now that permits are being filed, that kind of tells me that they might have some ideas. And now with Bruce Vaughn back on board, he has his team looking into it for new stories that new stories that we could be telling that are quite, you know, interesting, that he had mentioned back at a Destination D23. My question is, though, and this is where I'm getting a little bit confused, because in that article, it had mentioned the $60 billion that's going around all of the parks and resorts and experiences division. But primarily for the new station that dropped for the expansion for Walt Disney World with the agreement with the Oversight Tourism District, they're mentioning $17 billion. So we're getting like two different connections of where this money is coming from.
Right.
We got one that's coming from the Oversight Tourism District that they have an agreement with Walt Disney World for a $17 billion expansion, which is probably going to, but then they're also mentioning the $60 billion that's going to go spread around. Is the $17 billion part of the $60 billion? Because if it is, that's taking a big chunk.
Yes, because I think we figured it out with the parks specifically. Out of the $60 billion, I think only like 30 is billion. Going towards the actual park. So you're talking about 17, yet you're right. That would cut into almost all of it. I mean, or not all, like all of, like half of it.
That would leave like, what is it, 13 billion.
Billy. Yeah, exactly. So it's like, are they doing that? I don't know. I mean, that's a lot for Walt Disney World. And because then you got to split that up, though, between the other parks. Like, around, right. You know, you can't just do Disney World. So, yeah, I think it might be coming from different buckets. I'm not really sure, though. That is kind of confusing.
So I wonder if, because I remember when Ken Potruck mentioned at the Anaheim City Council that he said, you know, there's $60 billion on the table. I want Disneyland to have a big piece of that.
Right.
So, and you know, and that can only happen with the green light for Disneyland Forward, which thankfully it did happen. So it makes me wonder if Walt Disney World is going to get the $17 billion plus, maybe they might get a little bit off of the $30 billion, but maybe not all of it because they have a separate contract with the Oversight District.
Right.
And I kind of hope that is the case, because I think $17 billion is a lot for them to utilize over the next two decades. And I would like Disneyland to have a big chunk out of the $30 billion.
Yeah.
So that way both resorts can kind of do their thing. As I said, I think some of it is going to go towards the like Tokyo and the Asian parks, but
Tokyo has their own money.
Oh, that's right. Yeah. Tokyo. That's right. Tokyo has OLC, the Asian parks, Hong Kong and Shanghai. I think they'll get a little bit, but they already got Zootopia. They already got Frozen. I think they're good for the next couple years. I think if Disney World gets the $17 billion from, not from the Oversight District, let me rephrase, just the agreement that they're giving Disney the okay to invest the $17 billion. And then the $30 billion, I think it can probably be divvied up between Disneyland and Disneyland Paris.
Yeah. Yeah, we'll see. Yeah, Disneyland Resort, I think DCA is next up to bat. I think that whatever they're doing for that Simba lot is, I mean, whatever the first expansions are going to be, it's going to probably be in that Simba lot, probably Pandora. Yeah. I think Zootopia is on the table for DCA as well. Disneyland, I don't know. It's kind of hard for Disneyland because I feel like Disneyland is kind of okay right now. Like, I don't think Disneyland really needs to tap into its Disneyland Forward land yet. I would rather them tackle other things in the park, like Tomorrowland and things like that, before they get into like the land beyond, you know, so to speak. But who knows? Because they're probably itching to do the land beyond, like the Stitch parking lot, because that will probably be some princess thing like Frozen, and that's big money. So that they probably would prioritize that over Tomorrowland, right? But I think we're gonna get some stuff here at Disneyland. We'll see. I'm very, very curious. I hopefully, though, the bulk of it's for DCA right now, because DCA needs it so bad. It's crazy. Yes. It's crazy. So we'll see, man. It's exciting. It really is exciting. We only have a couple more months until D23. So we're going to know pretty soon what they have up their sleeves. And like I said, Josh D'Amaro, he's on the short list for CEO. He's going to want to deliver, dude. He's going to want to deliver just for his own career. He's going to want to hit a home run this time. So I'm pretty confident. But like I said, I've been stood up at the altar many times with Disney conventions, including Star Wars Celebration. So I don't want to get my hopes up too much.
Yeah.
But I'm confident. I'm cautiously optimistic. So
yes. Yeah. And during the time of this recording, we're also only a few days away from the 30-day mark being over for Disneyland Forward.
Yep, exactly. So crazy stuff. We're going to have a lot to report on. It's going to be nuts. But George, fantastic conversation. If you could let everybody at home know where they could find you on social media, sir.
Absolutely. You could find me on X, formerly known as Twitter, at Disney George. You could also find me on Instagram under the Disney Italiano. And of course, you could find me right here on my home base at Orange Grove 55 with Citrus Corner with all that sweet, juicy, but sometimes sticky Disney news and info.
There we go. So comment down below all your thoughts on everything we talked about today. A lot of exciting news coming out of Walt Disney World. What are your thoughts on Tiana breaking down and the fire alarms? Are you kind of like with me and George? Like, hey, I mean, it's soft openings. That's what these soft openings are for. Or does it seem unusual or excessive? We would love to hear from you if you think that as well. Comment down below. Thank you all so much for watching this episode of OG55.
Like iced tea, I'm OG. Like iced tea, I'm OG. Like iced tea, I'm OG. I'm demon like IT. Got more juice than high C.